In this video lecture, we want to give a short introductory overview of selection in Java, or more generally, in any other programming languages as well. Okay, let's get started. In the prior lecture materials, we discussed at length the idea of conditions as a precursor to talking about selection in programming. Recall that selection simply represents decision-making in programming, and it's the third of the four basic flows of control in programming, the others being sequential execution and method calls, which we've covered already, and looping, which we'll get to after this. There are two basic components needed to implement selection. The first one is conditions. Recall that we said that conditions simply represent forks in the road in any program execution path, and they allow us to express true-false decision-making programmatically. We express conditional statements using these nine conditional operators: the two equality operators, the four relational operators, and the three logical operators, which allow us to form compound, more complex conditional statements. Now we need to look at how to put such conditions to use. And for this, we need selection structures, which provide us with the code frameworks in which we can put to use any desired selection logic we've expressed in conditional statements. Selection structures are just some standard decision-making frameworks in our code. In them, certain statement paths are executed only if their associated conditions are true. Otherwise, if those associated conditions are false, those statement paths are ignored and are not executed. The execution paths through the various selection structures are often expressed visually using flowcharts, and we'll see some of these in a moment. For starters, let's say that we will be looking at the following five different selection structures: if, if-else, if-else-if, the conditional operator, and the switch statement. Different ones of these might be the most useful one to use, dependent upon a particular program logic situation. In this diagram, we see a comparison of the three possible if selection structures: if, if-else, and if-else-if. These are all examples of simple flowcharts, and they are arranged in order, left to right, from the simplest, most basic form on the left to the most general form on the right. All three of these if selection structures have one thing in common, and that's these condition blocks, shown as these blue diamonds. These all represent decision points, and this is where we would use conditions to decide what to do next. The first example on the left shows the simplest form, the if structure. In our program's execution flow, we reach this condition, we ask some yes-no question, and it's evaluated to a single Boolean true-false value. If the result is true, we take this path and execute this set of statements represented by the green true block. Otherwise, if the result is false, we take this path instead and nothing happens. Either way, we then pick up with the next statements shown here in this orange next block. The next example here in the middle shows the next slightly more generic form, the if-else structure. The same thing happens here. We reach this condition, we ask some yes-no question, and it's evaluated to a single Boolean true-false value. Once again, if the result is true, we take the left path and execute the set of statements represented by this true block. But now, if the result is false, rather than doing nothing, we instead execute the set of statements represented by this yellow false block. Just as before, either way, we then pick back up by executing the next statements in this orange next block. If you look at this closely, you'll see that this more general if-else structure reduces to the simpler if structure for the special case of no statements in the false block. Finally, the last example on the right shows the most general form, the if-else-if structure. Here we see that there is a cascaded series of conditions which are evaluated, rather than just one. This first condition is evaluated, and if the condition is true, the set of statements in this first true block are executed. Otherwise, if the first condition is false, then we proceed to the second condition, where the process is repeated. If the condition is true, this set of statements in the second true block are executed. Otherwise, if false, we then proceed to the third condition, and so forth. And we can stack as many of these conditions together as we need to. Finally, if the last condition in the chain evaluates to false, we would then default to this set of statements in this yellow false block, which actually can be optional. And once again, no matter what, all execution paths join back up and resume executing the next statements in this common orange next block. And once again, This if-else-if structure is a more general form of the if-else structure and reduces to it if we have only one of these conditions present. Depending upon the particular logical situation we're trying to implement in our code, we might choose a different one of the three if selection structures to use. The if structure is what we want to use if we are executing statements under one condition only, but not otherwise. For example, do something, but only if something is true. The if-else structure is the best choice if we want to execute different statements for either one of two mutually exclusive conditions. For example, we want to do something or do something else, but not both. Finally, the if-else-if structure is most appropriate if we want to execute different statements under some multiple mutually exclusive conditions. For example, we want to do this or do that for some arbitrary set of conditions. So taken together, these first three if selection structures give us the logical frameworks to handle any type of decision making needed in our programs. Next, we'll start taking a look at the details of each one of them and how they are implemented as Java code.